Okay, I want to preach this morning on In the Beginning. I've been preaching on the blessings of salvation, and I was working on that, but I felt really sick Thursday and a bit of Friday, and while I was sick, God laid this verse on my heart, and I felt like God would have me to preach on Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. I did not know when I started this message that I've actually preached on this verse four times before. Well, three times before. This is not the sermon that I preached before. It's just when you go to save it, I save it in the folder Genesis, and I could see it four times. It's such an important verse, though. It's not a verse that we can take lightly, actually. You see, Genesis is the introduction to the Bible. It's the beginning, and it's the first book of the Bible. And in Genesis, you find every major Bible doctrine. Now, usually, they're in types. A type is a divine picture. For example, in Exodus, we have the type, the Passover. A lamb is slain so that people could live. Well, that is a picture of Jesus Christ, right? That's a type. We have the offering of Jesus Christ with Abraham going to offer his son Isaac. And Isaac, by the way, you sometimes get the idea maybe he's a little child or a teenager. He was an adult man, okay, who willingly was going to let his father kill him. And that pictures Jesus Christ willingly die for us. So all the major doctrines in the Bible are covered in Genesis. Or I should say almost all, I guess. But many so-called Christians say Genesis isn't literal. These things didn't really happen. That's a lie. And that is an attack on God and his word. You know, Satan is a deceiver. Lies to work have to be deceptive, right? If I told you the sun is going to be purple tomorrow, you probably wouldn't believe me. There's no, you know, like, there's no reason to believe me. But a liar gives you something that is plausible in some ways. And so there's many false teachings out saying these things didn't really happen. They're just there to help us along. No, they really did happen, okay? Believe the Bible. It's true. So Genesis is the introductory book to the Bible, and Genesis 1:1 is the introduction to this book. And the very first thing we learn is that we have to go by faith. Because it says, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Anybody there? Anybody saw that? No, you didn't. I didn't see it either. You may think I'm old, but I'm not that old. Okay? We take it by what?
Faith.
So right at the very start, we see the Bible teaches that we have to take things by faith. But it's not blind faith, because the Bible says, through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are not seen, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. By faith we understand. People say, I don't know how many evolutionists I've said, talk to, say, well, it's just blind faith. I say, you got blind faith. You believe that something the size of a pin had exploded and all this order came out of disorder. That takes more faith. It's not blind faith, but it is faith. So when we come to the book of Genesis, we take it by what?
Faith.
Let's say only a few people said it. So we come to the book of Genesis and we take it by what?
Faith.
The just shall live by faith. Now, God doesn't explain himself. Sometimes when you read books about people, they start, you know, explaining about this person before you. God doesn't do that. God does not explain himself. He just gets in and tells us what he's done. If God was to explain himself, we would have a Bible bigger than the universe. We could never understand all there is of God. And he expects us to just believe what he says. And as we read it through, we learn about God. And we learn much about God from his creations. The heavens declare the glory of God. We learn about God, obviously, most importantly, through the Bible, but we also learn about God through his creation. And I'll talk about this. So, God is without beginning or ending, and God precedes the beginning. In the beginning, that God created. Therefore, God was before anything that was created, right? God is eternal. And this verse immediately denies atheism because it says there's a God. It denies polytheism because there's only one God. It denies pantheism because God is not in everything. God made everything. It denies materialism. It denies fatalism. This verse shows that God is above all and before all. And so I want us to consider this verse this morning. First of all, in the beginning. Therefore, there is a beginning. Time started. Time is something that has been created. Did you ever think about that? Time is created. Before creation, there was no time. The Bible says in Psalm 90, verse 2, before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hast formed the earth and the world, from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. God was before his creation. And this is important because God is eternal. And only God is eternal. And obviously, his creation isn't eternal. Obviously, it's not eternal because he created it. In the beginning, God created. So, everything that you see was made. Time is created. There's a beginning. And this shows us that God is separate from his creation. You know, there's people, Mother Earth and all this. And, there is no such thing as Mother Earth. God created the earth. And everything that is, God created it. God, but everything is not part of God. Though God created it, this world is not part of God. You understand what I'm saying? There's people that say, we're all part of God. No, we're not all part of God. God created. God is separate from creation. Now, we are created, but we're not eternal. But you can have eternal life. So I have a beginning, but I don't have an ending. The Bible says, for whosoever believeth him shall not perish, but have eternal life. And so when people attack Genesis and say it didn't really happen like this, it's actually an attack on the fact that you can have eternal life even. Because they're denying God. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is what? Eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. So, my life has a beginning, but my life doesn't have an ending. I got saved in 1977, and I have eternal life. Before that, I was facing eternal death. Matthew 25:46. And these shall go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into life eternal. So God is without beginning or without end. I have a beginning, but praise the Lord, I don't have an end. Amen? I have eternal life, and that's a wonderful thought. Now, in the beginning, God created. I don't know Hebrew. I know a little bit of Hebrew, but it's kind of important for us to know. The word God here is a plural term with a singular verb, Elohim. Let me read you this quote. Elohim, a plural word in form, but joined with a verb singular, except when it refers to false gods of the heathens, in which case it takes a plural. So, in the beginning, God. So, we don't have in the English language a word to, like Elohim, but we know that God is plural but singular. How can you be plural but singular? Well, that's called the Trinity. You don't find the word Trinity in the Bible, but you find the doctrine, and I'll talk about this later on. But God created. And God said, let, what's the next word? Us make man in what? Our image. One God in three persons, having the same nature. So, in your Bible, if you take a look at it, you see Genesis 1:1 is capital G-O-D. That is Elohim. But when you have capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, that's a different Hebrew word. That Hebrew word is, anybody know? Jehovah. So when you see in your Bible, in the King James Bible, God's hand was on the King James Bible to help you. Without it, so just look at, for example, turn to Psalm 26, or sorry, 25. I'm preaching Sunday evening through Psalm 25. So let's look at Psalm 25. Verse 1. Unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. Notice that Lord, it's capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. Therefore, that word is what? Jehovah. Then in verse 2, O my God, I trust in thee. God here would be the word what? Elohim. Now, Elohim, you understand, there's a plurality. But Jehovah, it's not. And God uses different names to help us to understand who he is. And why would God use the word Elohim here instead of Jehovah? Well, so that you right away know that God is a triune person. One God, just one God. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one God, but in three persons. Okay, so now the word God, let me read you this. Many attempts have been made to define the term God. As to the word itself, it is a pure Anglo-Saxon word. So God, what we say in the English language, it didn't come from a Latin or anything. It's an Anglo-Saxon word, okay? And it signifies divine being. And when it was first started, it also had the understanding that it was good. So God originally would have been understood as a good divine being. That's who he is, amen? He's a good divine being. And so we have the Trinity. For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. And these three are one. 1 John 5:7. By the way, if you have a new version, that's not in there. It's terrible. They've taken it out. Anyways, that's another thing. 2 Corinthians, listen to this. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Son, and love of God, the Father, and the communion of the Holy Ghost, that's the Holy Spirit, be with you all. Amen. So, God later develops and shows us who he is. He's the triune God. But he created. That is, he made something out of nothing. He caused to come into existence something that was not there before. People talk about the creations that humans have made. Humans have never created anything. Humans have used what God has done to make things. But God created. God made something out of nothing. The Bible says in Hebrews 11, verse 3, through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. God made them. God made them, and he says, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. That's a summary. And then he goes down through Genesis 1 and explains what he did. God created, if you just look at verse 21, it says, God created great whales and every living creature that moveth, which the waters brought forth abundantly after their kind, and every winged fowl after his kind. And God saw that it was good. God created. Things didn't come, evolve. God created. And God said his creation was what? Anybody see that? Good. Let me ask you a question. If it has to evolve from one thing to another thing, is it good? No, it's not good. It has to get better. And that's what the world is telling us. Evolution has to be there to get rid of Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created. Evolution says God didn't create. God says, I created. One's lying. God created. And man didn't evolve. You see, evolution teaches us that we're animals. And it's no wonder people act like animals. We're not animals. We are above animals. And I'm not going to get into all of this, but it says in verse 27, so God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. God made humans particularly special. We are above animals. You know, you've got this Just Stop Oil thing going on. Did you read about that in the news? People all over the world, in different places in the world, are stopping traffic and they've got Just Stop Oil. Anybody read about any of that? I'm the only person? Okay. Because, I just thought about how hypocritical it was, because they've got this big sign that they're holding up. But you know, that sign is made of plastic. Where did plastic come from? Oil. Then they've got these plastic vests on. Where did these vests come from? Oil. I really wanted to go out and say to them. But the point is, they're saying that there's this teaching that we're all equal. We're equal to the animals. We're not equal to the animals. We were created in God's image. Cows weren't created in God's image. Horses weren't created in God's image. Man was. And God created us. And God created everything. If you just look at chapter 2, verse 3, it says, and God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his work which God created and made. God made everything. God made everything. And, you know, think about the power of God to make everything. God is all powerful. He has the power to create everything. When we think of this, the power of God, in the beginning, God created the heaven and earth. Think of the power of God. This verse, although it doesn't come out and say God is all powerful, it teaches us God is all powerful. Amen? Only an all powerful God could create the heaven and the earth. God is all wise. You know, I was thinking about the earth this week, and I was thinking how, do you know, all the planets pull on each other, and we've got to have this the planetary system to keep the earth exactly in the right orbit. I mean, the wisdom of God to do that, the wisdom of God to be able to make the sun just the right size, so it was not, so if it was too big, we'd fry. If it's too small, we'd freeze. Just the wisdom of God. In the beginning, God created us, tells us that we have an all-powerful, all-wise God. And he made everything perfect. I don't know, you ever made something and you think, oh, this is great, and then it breaks? Anybody ever done that? Yeah? Okay. We just don't, or you make something. This is me. You've got the thing, and you make it, and you've got all the directions, and you finish, and you got extra pieces left over. Anybody ever done that? Yeah. We're not, I mean, these are simple things. God made everything perfect. Listen to Deuteronomy 32, verse 4. He is the rock. His work is perfect. For all his ways are judgment. A God of truth and without iniquity. Just and right is he. His work is perfect. And look at it, verse 4 of Genesis 1. And God saw, verse 3. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided light from darkness. God made light. Think about that. God made light. We think of light as just visible light, but there's light that's not even visible. That God made it all. What an amazing God. I wonder in heaven will we be able to see the spectrum of light above what we can see now. Maybe. Maybe there's other colors there that we will learn about in heaven. God made it all. I mean, and it was good. Genesis 1:31. And God saw everything that he made, and behold, it was very good. And the evening and the morning were the sixth day. God says, when he's finished it all, and he said, it's not just good, it was what? Very good. I mean, think of the wisdom and understanding that God has. God is all-knowing. And in Genesis 1:1, we see this, that he's all-knowing, omniscient. I mean, to be able to put all this together, God had to be all-knowing, didn't he? The complexity. You know, when I was in secondary school, we learned in biology about the amoeba. And you know what an amoeba is? They called it a simple one-celled animal. But you know what? There's nothing simple about it. It is more complex than any computer we have. One cell. A one-cell animal is more complex than any computer that the world has today. What an amazing God. What an amazing God. The wisdom that he has. And think about this. Creation points to a loving creator. Listen to 1 Peter 4:19. Wherefore, let him that suffereth according to the will of God commit the keeping of their souls to him in well-doing as unto a faithful creator. God made this world, and you know what he did? He gave it to mankind. What a loving God. Amen. Creation points to a loving, wise, all-powerful, all-knowing God. And think about it. God just spoke it into existence in Genesis 1:3. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. Verse 6. And God said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters. Verse 9, and God said, let the waters under the heaven be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear, and it was so. And Genesis 1:1 does away with evolution and any other false teaching. It does away with all the false gods of the world. It does away with everything. You know, I was reading about the Mormon religion this week, they believe that there's other gods. Genesis 1:1 does away with that. God created everything. It's just what a wonderful God we have. And we have the Trinity in creation. The Bible says in Psalm 33, verse 6, by the word of the Lord were the heavens made, and all the hosts of them by the breath of his mouth. Now, in verse 2, we see the Trinity at work. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. We have Elohim, and we see that's God, and we see God the Holy Spirit, right in verse 2. And, of course, you know, Genesis, John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And, well, just go ahead and turn to John 1. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. And the Word was, verse 14, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So the Word is who? Who is the Word?
God.
God. And which person? Who became flesh?
God the Son.
God the Son. Jesus Christ. So we see Jesus Christ made everything. God the Father made everything. God, Holy Spirit. Understand, the Trinity works together in everything. Okay? The Trinity works together in creation. The Trinity works together in salvation. The Trinity works together because how many gods are there?
One
God. One God. So it says, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. I got a lot to say and my time's kind of running out here, so I might have to skip a bit of the sermon. Let's go back to our verse. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. God created everything. You've got the heaven. That's everything that's not on the earth. So the heaven, this is, verse 1 is a summary. Anything that's not on the earth is the heaven. So that's the planets. That's the stars. That's the moon. God created it all. And he says that in Isaiah 45. I'm going to read verses 5, 12, and 18. Thus saith God the Lord, He that created the heavens, and He stretched them out. He spread forth the earth, and that which cometh out of it. He giveth bread unto the people of it, and the spirit to them that walk therein. I have made the earth, and created man upon it. I, even my hands, have stretched out the heavens, and all their hosts I have commanded it. For thus saith the Lord that created the heavens, God himself that formed the earth and made it, he hath established it. He created it not in vain. He formed it to be inhabited. I am the Lord. There is none else. Pretty plain there. God made everything and there's nobody else. Amen? Like I said, the Mormons believe there's other gods besides God. God says no. And Genesis 1:1 does away with it, because in the beginning God created. What did he create?
Everything.
Amen. He created everything. There's nothing made that God did not make. He says the heaven, everything in them. I mean, it's the heaven is immense, but it's finite. It's not infinite. We don't have telescopes that can go to the end of the universe, but there is an end. It's not eternal. It's created. It's not self-existent. God keeps everything. Do you know the sun is burning up? And what's going to stop it from burning up? God. God keeps everything in place. And so the heavens, everything out there, all those stars that are burning up, what's keeping everything in place? God. God did it. He made the earth. I mean, just think about the complexity. The human body has between 10 and 100 billion cells. Trillion cells. That's a lot of cells, isn't it? It's hard to get an exact number. Nobody knows. But 100, just say 50 trillion cells. What an amazing God that he could make a person. And obviously, when God made creation, he made it with apparent age. What do I mean by he made it with apparent age? Well, the animals, were they babies or were they adult animals? They were adult. Adam, was he an adult or was he a baby? Adult. The trees were mature trees. Everything was made with apparent age, as if, obviously, because it wouldn't work without that, would it? I mean, if Adam had to wait till the trees got, 10 years old to have fruit, what would he do in the meantime? God knew what he was doing. Just an amazing God. Just think of the complexity. I don't know why. I was just watching some YouTube videos on bees, and it's just an amazing thing, you know. The plants, they rely upon the bees, right? The bees rely upon the plants. What they call that, a symbiotic relationship. There's so many things. What would the bees do if there was no plants? They would die. What would plants do without bees to pollinate? You see, God, in his wisdom, made everything. Think about this. God made birds being able to migrate thousands of miles, kilometers. That's an amazing thing, isn't it? I mean, birds from Northern Europe fly down into Africa every year. And then they fly back. And they don't have a GPS phone. The GPS phone brought Brother Mark over there somewhere. And he was going to climb the wall. But God gave them an inbuilt GPS. What an amazing God. Amen? In the beginning, God created. What a great God. Think about this. God knew that some animals would need to hibernate during the winter. And I was reading about... I don't know how I knew about it. An animal. And it can... It doesn't go into hibernation, but it goes into almost hibernation, and it brings its body temperature down and brings it down to like 5 degrees, so it doesn't produce any heat to save. And then when the conditions are better, it comes back to life. That doesn't happen by chance. God created. What an amazing God! I mean, what an amazing God! I mean, you just think about the bears in Canada, and they go to sleep for the winter. It's just an amazing God. I mean, think about the tides. Do you ever think about this? You know how the moon has the gravitational pull to the Earth, and that is why we have tides. Now, if you didn't have tides, what would the biggest problem be? The oceans would be stagnant. What happens to water if it just sits still?
Stinks
and rots and nothing can live in it. What an amazing God. He said, I'll put that moon out there and it's going to pull up the water and the water will move down. And so the water is always moving and that will create currents and the water will be able to keep life. What an amazing God. I mean, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. The hydrological cycle that takes water, that evaporates it and brings it up in the clouds and then rains down and brings water to places where there's no rivers and lakes. Just an amazing God. But now let me say this. Because God is our creator, we have a responsibility to him. Relationship demands responsibility. Relationship. God, creator. Human, creation. Therefore, we are responsible to our creator, right? And so, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, teaches us that we are responsible to who? God. I am not responsible to myself. I am responsible to God. Not what I think, but what God says. Not my morals, but God's morals. And so, it's a powerful verse because relationship demands responsibility. Relationship of creator to creation. If you're employed, you're responsible to your employer, right? So, we have a responsibility to God Almighty. Genesis 1:1 teaches us that. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Therefore, I am responsible to my creator. You know, it's interesting, as I said, evolutionists and atheists, a lot of them are saying, you know, we have a responsibility to our environment. We do, because God gave us dominion over the earth, okay? That comes from the Bible. That's true. But what's not true is that the earth is equal to humans. But we do have a responsibility to the earth. But it's because God created it. Amen? Because God created it. Not because it's equal, but it's a creation of God that we were given responsibilities. And it's interesting. I once had a man tell me that even God, even if God did create us, he says, I don't see myself having a responsibility to God. Well, that just was a rebellious heart. But as you see, there's a creation. Therefore, we are responsible to the Creator. And we are responsible to look after God's creation. But most of all this, we have a responsibility to glorify God because He is our Creator. In the beginning, God created. Therefore, I must glorify God. Understand that creation is supposed to, the heavens declare what?
The glory of God.
The glory of God. God's creation should bring Him what?
Glory.
Therefore, Genesis 1:1 teaches us that my responsibility to God is to bring Him glory. The Bible says, whether therefore you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God. Teaches me that I have a responsibility to keep His commandments. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes, remember now thy Creator in the days of thy youth. I have a responsibility to follow God's laws. Creation shows that God has laws. How does that show? Well, the earth is in orbit. It follows God's law. The earth rotates. It's following God's law. The planets move according to God's law. Therefore, I should obey God's law. Amen? Creation points to the responsibility to a Creator. Now, creation points to I need to follow God's word. How do I know about creation? Because Genesis 1:1 told me. Amen? So if I'm going to believe Genesis 1:1, I better believe the rest of the book. Amen? And I better follow it. That's what God expects from me. So Genesis 1:1 teaches me that I am responsible to read God's word and find out what it says. I am to serve Him. I am accountable to Him. So Genesis 1:1 doesn't just talk about creation. It tells us much about our Creator. And it tells us about our responsibility to Him. First of all, your responsibility to Him is come to know Him as your personal Savior. You know, so many people are religious but lost. They've never been born again. Unless you're born again, you're never going to get to heaven. You've got to be born again. Jesus said, unless a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. He can't come into that spiritual kingdom. That's a spiritual birth. And you get that by receiving Jesus Christ as your Savior. At 17 years old, if you asked me, did Jesus die for the world? I probably would have said yes. But I was lost. I'm on my way to hell. But I received Jesus as my Savior. And if you're here this morning and you've never been born again, I'd like to show you from the Bible how you can be. I'll meet with you. I just tell you quickly, it's by receiving Jesus Christ by faith and trusting in Him alone. But I'd like to meet with you and talk to you. And if you're here this morning and you're not saved, talk to me and I'll show you from the Bible. We'll set a time aside and we'll just go through the Bible and I'll show you how you can have eternal life in heaven. Christian, in the beginning God created you. God gave you life. Therefore, you're responsible to Him. Are you living for Him? Are you making your life count for Him? Are you following His ways and His rules? Because we are accountable to Him. Amen? Amen. Let's close in a word of prayer.